graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To the psalm, too wonderful for me this knowledge, too high beyond my reach.
Too wonderful for me this knowledge, too high beyond my reach.
O Lord, you search me and you know me. You know my resting and my rising. You discern my purpose from afar. You mark when I walk or lie down. All my ways lie open to you.
Too wonderful for me this knowledge, too high beyond my reach.
Before ever a word is on my tongue, you know it, O Lord, through and through. Behind and before you besiege me, your hand ever laid upon me.
Too wonderful for me this knowledge, too high beyond my reach.
Oh, where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your face? If I climb the heavens, you are there. If I lie in the grave, you are there. Too wonderful for me this knowledge,
too high beyond my reach.
For it was you who created my being, knit me together in my mother's womb. I thank you for the wonder of my being, for the wonders of all your creation.
Too wonderful for me this knowledge, too high beyond my reach.
To me, how mysterious your thoughts, the sum of them not to be numbered. If I count them, they are more than the sand. To finish, I must be eternal like you.
Too wonderful for me this knowledge, too high beyond my reach.
O search me, God, and know my heart. O test me and know my thoughts. See that I follow not the wrong path, and lead me in the path of life eternal.
Too wonderful for me this knowledge, too high beyond my reach. Reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they talked with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels, who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. And then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" And then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. And as they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if to go on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us. It is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." And then they told them what had happened on the road and how he had been known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
May the words of the Gospel wipe away our sins. Nicholas once said of this gospel, and I quote him, "If, shipwrecked on a desert island, I were allowed only two passages of scripture, they would be the prologue to the fourth gospel and the story in Luke of the journey to Emmaus." Little surprise then that this was the gospel chosen by both Nicholas and Jan 45 years ago for their nuptial mass here in Fisher House. And if I remember rightly, it was also chosen for their 25th anniversary, also celebrated here in 2000. It's not hard to understand their choice. This account is one of the richest and most memorable of all the post-resurrection appearances. Luke, at his best, moves our hearts and feeds our minds, just as Jesus did for those two disconsolate disciples despondently departing Jerusalem. Having opened their minds to the scriptures, he then opened their eyes and hearts to himself in the breaking of the bread, a phrase which even by that time had become shorthand for the Eucharist. But the story has an unexpected twist. At the precise moment of recognition, he's taken from their sight. At this point, you might have expected them to be cast back into their gloom. But no, on the contrary, they hurry back to Jerusalem, carrying the news that the women were right after all. He had risen. He was alive. Now, the Greek is both more subtle and more specific than this English translation. It says, "He became invisible to them." Not that he vanished and was no longer with them. So what restored their hope and rekindle their faith was the reassurance that that his presence wasn't bounded by perception, and his life had not ended with his death. That this gospel, so full of hope and faith and reassurance, should be chosen for both a nuptial mass and a requiem mass couldn't be more apt. It's a powerful reminder to us that viewed through the prism of the resurrection, living and dying are one inextricably interwoven reality, made so by love. Love is the key to both living well and dying well. And that's why our lives are not measured by an account of our deeds only, but by the degree to which our life as a whole has been suffused with selfless love. The letting be and letting go that is the hallmark of a life lived selflessly is also the hallmark of a death accepted selflessly. To live and to die in Christ is to be united with him in both his life-giving love and his love-sealing death. Whether we live or whether we die, says St. Paul, we are the Lord's. But what is it to live in the Lord from day to day? It is to live in such a way that all I do is done also by him. What is it to die in the Lord? It is to die in such a way that my dying is an act of total acceptance and self-abandonment, as his was, for our sake. This short handwritten prayer I found scribbled in an ancient and battered missal belonging to another old friend shortly after his death. Lord, so act in me that all I do is done also by thee. Of course, the moment and mode of our death may not leave room for a final conscious act of acceptance, but it will be implicit and no less real if, through the constant exercise of charity by which we are united to Christ, we have become, by the time of our dying, obedient unto death, as he was. And that's why the whole of our life is a preparation for death. As Herbert McCabe once wrote, with his usual relish for the seemingly paradoxical, for a Christian, there's nothing in life more important than death. And it takes, quite literally, a lifetime to learn how to die, just as it takes a lifetime to learn how to love. When Jesus articulated the central mystery at the heart of our existence, that we gain our life only by losing it, he wasn't using a figure of speech or speaking about living only. Our salvation is secured by the letting go that is love in both our living and our dying. As another stalwart of Fisher House and a much missed friend, Jonathan Riley Smith, wrote as he prepared for his own death almost 4 years ago now, death is not just unavoidable, but necessary. And so we can embrace death, not just death, the great abstraction, but our own death, knowing that in St. Gregory of Nazianzen's words, our dying is not a drawing back, loath to depart, not being dragged and torn from this life, as if enthralled by this world, but rather a going forth, readily and willingly, to eternal happiness in Christ Jesus, our Lord. In all his theological exploration, Nicholas was an avowed enemy of intellectual pretension and false certainty. But there was one certainty of which he himself was assured, which he articulated on an occasion similar to this. He was preaching at the Requiem Mass in 1988 for his friend and first parish priest, David Woodward, with reference to the first reading from Ezekiel, the Valley of Bones, which was used on that occasion also. His words then about his friend and mentor are equally apt of Nicholas himself. Again, I quote him with only a change of name. Our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. Not so. Nicholas lived the denial of that despair with passion. And this Eucharist, which we celebrate today, in gratitude for his life and ministry, we celebrate with him in the certainty that God's Spirit will breathe flesh onto our bones and at the last will bring us all home. May Nicholas rest in peace and rise in glory. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Lord God, we ask you to receive us and be pleased with the sacrifice we offer you with humble and contrite hearts.
Lord, wash away my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sins. Let us pray that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, our good and good Lord's Church.
Look favourably upon our offerings, O Lord, so that your servant Nicholas may be taken up into glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united. We ask you this through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him, the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for us in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In the same way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your Church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Alan, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant Nicholas, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember all our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. You who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. May this mingling of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring eternal life to us who receive it. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Christ, bring me to everlasting life. Amen. the body of Christ. 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 The body of Christ.
Christianity, then, is at once a philosophy, a political power, and a religious rite. As a religion, it is holy. As a philosophy, it is apostolic. As a political power, it is imperial, that is, one and Catholic. As a religion, its special center of action is pastor and flock. As a philosophy, the schools. As a rule, the papacy and its curia. Truth is the guiding principle of theology and theological inquiries, devotion and edification of worship, and of government expedience. The instrument of theology is reasoning, of worship, our emotional nature, of rule, command, and coercion. Further, in man as he is, reasoning tends to rationalism, devotion to superstition and enthusiasm, and power to ambition and tyranny. Who, in St. Paul's words, is sufficient for these things? Who, even with divine aid, shall successfully administer offices so independent of each other, so divergent, and so conflicting? What line of conduct, except on the long, the very long run, is at once edifying, expedient, and true? Is it not plain that if one determinate course is to be taken by the Church, acting at once in all three capacities, so opposed to each other in their idea, that course must, as I've said, be deflected from the line which would be traced out by any one of them if viewed by itself, or else the requirements of one or two sacrificed to the interest of the third? To conclude, whatever is great refuses to be reduced to human rule and to be made consistent in its many aspects with itself. Who shall reconcile with each other the various attributes of the infinite God? And as he is, such in their several degrees are his works. This living world to which we belong, how self-contradictory it is when we attempt to measure and master its meaning and scope, and how full of incongruities, that is, of mysteries, in its higher and finer specimens, is the soul of man, viewed in its assemblage of opinions, tastes, habits, powers, aims, and doings. We need not feel surprised, then, if Holy Church too, the supernatural creation of God, is an instance of the same law, presenting to us an admirable consistency and unity in word and deed as her general characteristic, but crossed and discredited now and then by apparent anomalies which need and which claim at our hands an exercise of faith.
First of all, thank you for coming. Thank you, Bishop Allen. Thank you, Father Alban. Thank you, family and dear, dear friends. What do you say about someone you've loved and lived with for nearly 45 years? I'm up far too close. I knew him far too well, and yet, particularly since his death, I've been profoundly conscious of his irreducible otherness. When he was denied his second perseverance after 6 months as a novice at Downside, he asked his Irish confessor why they were throwing him out. "I think the day thinks that you're too full of life and beans," he replied. Full of life and beans, Nicholas remained almost to the end. Even during the last 5 months, when he was confined to bed and totally dependent on me and his carers who looked after, the carers who looked after him, he could still raise a smile with a pun or a joke. Life with Nicholas, on the whole, was fun. He threw himself into everything he did, whether it was planning a holiday, buying the perfect wine to go with a particular dish, or finding the right words to express a difficult concept. He was highly cerebral, immensely articulate, and yet, in a very English public school way, very inarticulate about his feelings. He loved company, was never happier than when eating and drinking, especially drinking, with his friends, and he was at his happiest during late-night sessions at the Catholic Theological Association conferences, a glass of whiskey in his hand, singing raucous songs, or arguing about some theological point. In his prime, he had an apparently inexhaustible collection of funny anecdotes. Over the years, they became a canon, and his friends, including Father Alban, would sometimes roll their eyes when he began, "Have I told you?" and launched into a story they'd already heard 50 or 100 times before. But new acquaintances would be enchanted. When he was born in the foothills of the Himalayas, where his father was serving as an officer in the Royal Garhwal Rifles, Nicholas's family had been involved with India for nearly 150 years. On the Lash side, there were Anglican missionaries. His uncle Bill was an Anglican Franciscan, a friend of Gandhi, and sometime Bishop of Bombay. On his maternal side, there was a Protestant Irish provost of Trinity College, but the Scottish Stranges, one of whom became Chief Justice of Madras in 1801, were the most interesting and sometimes dissolute. One was a bodyguard and drinking companion Bonnie Prince Charlie. It was from them that he inherited his Catholicism, and the family traced its creativity. Nicholas's interest in theology was sparked and encouraged by his gloriously eccentric Benedictine uncle, Sebastian Moore. His late brother, Christopher, no intellectual slouch himself, despite having only managed a fourth at Oxford because he spent most of his time acting, became a distinguished Syriac scholar and Greek Orthodox archimandrite. He developed a magnificent beard and produced elegant translations of Greek liturgical texts. His two younger sisters, one of whom Susanna is here, shared the family creativity, both writing novels and painting. Ginny, the elder, was the mother of six children, five of them conspicuously artistic, including the actors Rafe and Joe Fiennes. The sixth, Jake, the sane one, as Nicholas used to say, is an ecologist. As a child, Nicholas seems to have had a precocious ability with language. Arriving back in England, when he was nearly 11, having been stuck in India during the war, he was sent to prep school at Worth. On his first night, a skinny, owlish little Nicholas turned up in his housemaster's study. "Sir," he said, "I wish to report a most singular occurrence. My pajamas have disappeared." Language always mattered to him. He knew its power for good and ill. A theologian, he used to say, quoting the Australian Jesuit Jerry O'Collins, was someone who watches their language in the presence of God. When I met him in 1974, he said his adult life was divided into sixes: 6 years in the army, 6 in the seminary, 6 as a curate near Slough, and the last 6 in Cambridge. After leaving the monastery and after 3 months visiting his uncle Bill, the bishop, in Bombay, he gave up a scholarship to read maths at Emmanuel because it brought prestige but no money, and did his national service in the army, followed by a short service commission, served with endurance in a rather grim post-war Germany and delight in Hong Kong. But the priesthood still called, and so he entered the seminary in Oscott and was ordained for the Diocese of Northampton in 1963. There followed 6 busy years as curate to Father David Woodard in Burnham during the exciting days of the Second Vatican Council. At David's instigation, he listened to Vatican radio and read the transcripts of the council debates before presenting the parish with a distillation of analysis of what had happened that week. It was David who persuaded his bishop, Charles Grant, to send him to St. Edmund's House, as it was then, to do a doctorate. He always said that meeting me was the catalyst, but not the cause of his seeking laicization, because at Cambridge he had discovered that his vocation was to be an academic theologian rather than a pastor. I will forbear indulging in further anecdotes. I just want to mention three things which, to me, say a lot about what made Nicholas Nicholas. First was his lifelong passionate interest, both intellectual and affective, in the life of the church. He was certainly not pious, but he was, I think, devout. The second is more personal. When in 1980 our son was born by elective caesarean section, Nicholas was present, all dolled up in green gown and funny hat, and he was rather traumatized by the whole thing. While they sewed me up, they handed the baby to his father. As I watched, Dominic opened his eyes, and I saw Nicholas fall in love with him. The third involved a particularly painful decision when in 1985 he resigned his fellowship at St. Edmund's in protest at the election of a master, the first after the bishops had handed the property to the fellows so that it could become a full college. A master who was both an atheist and well interviewed said that he understood the college's Catholic history, Catholic heritage, as part of its history, like that of any other college of the university. Nicholas considered the election as a betrayal. His resignation cost him dear. He was grateful to the sanctuary of Clare Hall, but he never loved it as he had St. Edmund's, and he was delighted in recent years to watch what seemed to him to be a return to the more thoroughgoing Catholicism of the college's past. Thanks to the kindness of Father Richard Inkleton, the then chaplain, as Father Orban has mentioned, we were married here in Fisher House, in the Fisher room next door, which was then the chapel. That was in February 1976. During Mass, Father Richard's Cavalier King Charles Spaniel, Phil, whose portrait with his master is in the dining room, across the passageway there, Phil lay under the credence table. I'm half expecting Audrey, Father Mark's dog, to come hurtling in at some point. We're here to bury Nicholas, not to praise him. He wasn't a saint, and no one was more conscious of his faults than he was. Our dear dead friend, Mary Thatcher, once said to me, "He is very irritating, but we love him." And that was true. Nicholas often said that he believed in resurrection, but not life after death. "I believe," he wrote somewhere, "that human beings die, and that although human beings are created and called by a love stronger even than death, they are capable of resisting and refusing, definitively refusing, that call, that love." There are, it seems, really only two possibilities for the future of each one of us and of the world. We die either into annihilation or into life, into God. I saw during the last years of increasing diminishment something I can only describe as virtue. He wasn't by temperament a patient man, and his quiet acceptance of the trials and humiliations of his last 5 months of total dependence surprised me. Apart from the occasional "get on with it" to his carers, he was uncomplaining, but he was very ready to die. The last years have been a gradual stripping down. With the waning of his physical and intellectual powers, the old acerbity fell away, and he became immensely gentle and accepting. The awarding of the papal knighthood in 2017 gave him immense pleasure, and for that I'm eternally grateful to Father Mark and to you, Bishop Allen. His one regret about the papal knighthood was that he wasn't young enough to take advantage of the right he had to ride his horse in St. Peter's Square. Nicholas died in the house where we'd lived our entire married life. A week or so before he died, I asked him what he was doing while he was lying there. Was he praying? I don't know, he said. I suppose I just look at him, and he looks at me. That might be a definition of heaven. May he rest in peace.
May Mary, the most merciful Virgin Mother of God, kindest comforter of all the mourn, commend the soul of the servant Nicholas to her Son. Through her maternal intercession, may he go forth to his longed-for home in heaven and live forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Let your spirit guide our days.